Do you see there being some larger feedback loop? Some people say the universe itself is conscious, or that societies can act as some larger level consciousness, like with each of us acting as neurons in some sense.
Well, I certainly wouldn't want to rule that view out a priori. I mean, it's obvious that we're embedded in much bigger systems. And I think we understand essentially nothing about the cognitive capacities of those systems.
Yeah.
Michael.
Yeah. I think that's a really important question. And I think a lot about the perspective of, let's say, you know, if you were a neural network or something like this being trained and so on, what would the perspective of a sub component of that be? Where, you know, let's say if you had the capacity as a neuron to sort of look around and ask yourself, you know, do I live in a cold mechanical universe that doesn't care what happens? Or is there some sort of agency in my environment that, you know, am I, when I'm as a piece of that network, am I learning from my environment, or am I being trained? Right? Because when you're being trained, right, the real question is like, how many agents are there in that interaction? Is it just you learning as you will? You're the boss and you're sort of learning whatever from your environment. Or are you actually being trained because the environment is an agent with an agenda that is training you for some particular purpose, right? And so this question of how would you know? So you look around and you say to yourself, well, if you're a piece of this network and it's being trained for some image recognition task, you know, you would be, I think, wrong to come to the conclusion that you live in a mechanical universe. You should come to the conclusion that it's clearly rewarding you and punishing you for specific things. It's not neutral with respect to what you do. And for some reason, it really likes it when you find, you know, you find pictures of dog eyes or something like this. And you have no idea that what it does is recognize dog faces out of, you know, all the other inputs. So no doubt there's some kind of Gödelian limit to be able to actually understand what the larger system is doing. But I wonder if we can even have some evidence that just for the fact that, yes, there is a greater, you know, sort of agential dynamic going on in which I'm caught up, even if you're not able to, you know, sort of comprehend what that's going to be. I don't know what that's going to look like, but I think it's pretty important. And I think, as Chris said, we really don't have a very good science at all of trying to predict or control the cognitive capacities of systems made up of parts. So we can know many things about parts, cells, robotics, whatever. And we routinely make these larger systems and then get surprised about what it does or doesn't do, or what the goals are going to be, what goals is it capable of pursuing, what preferences does it have. This is probably an existential level job for society is to get a good science of that going.
You have done that though, haven't you?
Well, we've started anyway.
I mean, I would go further than that. I think your work would represent a substantive and established formal framework to address exactly those issues. And you can see your embryonic versions arising in many different fields. I just came back from a meeting of economists and financiers, and they are trying to make the move from behavioral economics to cognitive economics. And they were exactly addressing these kinds of issues. You're understanding the notion of distributed cognition in a market. So, you know, and ultimately they'll come knocking at your door. I can see that. I can see exactly the sequence of people, you know, searching around for people to talk about, illuminating that realization that it comes back to what we were talking about before, where you started, and, you know, I was picking up on the link between different scales of self-organization, where every scale has, you know, compliance with the same principles, but how does that contextualize? And I think one really interesting example of that is to think about an individual in an ensemble or a society. And just to wrestle the argument back, to pick up on something that Chris was saying about, you know, if there is a bright line between the kind of mechanics that would qualify as conscious in the sense of being self-aware, and I'm distinguishing that from the kind of consciousness that would just entail qualitative experience, you know, and a loss of phenomenal transparency. So I'm talking about now self-awareness as, you know, one of the bright lines that may be very blurry and vague, but certainly one which is induced by the hard problem. You know, just asking a simple question, you know, what kind of explanation for my world, whether I'm a single neuron or a single person, would enable me or justify the notion that I am a self? And the obvious answer is when I have to disambiguate between the consequences of my action and your action, if you are very similar to me. So if I, you know, manage to survive on an alien planet where there are no structures like me that could cause the same sensed consequences, then there would be no problem inferring, did I cause that or did you cause that? So just having the existence of a population of conspecifics in some sort of formal structural sense suddenly induces the inference problem, did you cause that or do I cause that? And of course, that naturally calls for generative models or internal dynamics representations on the inside that entertain the hypothesis or the notion that that's me as opposed to not me. So you get for free, in and only in this context where you've put lots of these particles together, the license or the motivation to have a hypothesis, a representation of selfhood that, you know, from the statistician's point of view, is exactly the justification for the increased complexity that Chris was talking about. So I was listening to that really interesting sort of nod to IIT and all it brings to the table in terms of this sort of, you know, commitment to some threshold crossing or traversing a cut with increasing complexity. But why? I mean, one simple answer is that if you ask a statistician, what is complexity? And they'll tell you, well, it's basically the degrees of freedom you're using up to explain some sensory data. You could articulate it as a KL or relative entropy between a posterior and a prior if you're a Bayesian, but in essence, it's just the degrees of freedom you're using in order to accurately explain these data. So mathematically, the evidence is equal to the accuracy minus the complexity. So why would you need, why is that useful? Well, an increase in complexity is only licensed by an increase in the accuracy. So the simple argument would go, if I am obliged to model and predict and explain a world and that is constituted by other things like me, then the accuracy of my predictions will be greatly enhanced if I have a representation of me as distinct from you. And if that entails an increase in the degrees of freedom, namely adding in this extra kind of hypothesis and everything that it entails, then I'm going to have a greater complexity. But it's a complexity that is more than paid for by the increase in the accuracy. And just coming back to my original point, I think a lot of the work that you've done at the cellular level would be very gracefully translated to the societal level and to things like economics and to eco-niche construction in ethology. And I know Chris is probably wanting to say this, but language as one way of facilitating that notion, that ability to efficiently, with minimum complexity in this instance, do this distributed cognition. So I'm both being trained and learning at the same time, and we're doing it together to evince some kind of generalized synchrony. So I mentioned language for Chris there. And the fond hope he wants to pick that one up.
Well, again, what I'd actually like to do is back up a little bit and put some of what you just said into very simple active inference language. If I see something happening on my Markov blanket, on my interface with the world, then I always have the question, did I do that or did the world do that? Where the world means everything outside me. And in a sense, the answer is always the world did it. So the question becomes, did the world do that in response to something I did to it? Or did it just do it? Not in consequence of any of my actions. And so one gets immediately to this kind of babbling scenario that we've talked about many times, in which an infant or a robot or some system is trying to figure out by measuring correlations whether the world's inputs to it have anything to do with its inputs to the world. And just asking that question requires enormous representative capacity, because one has to represent one's actions and represent them pretty well in time. And one has to have a good memory to represent enough actions to get any kind of statistical support for drawing an inference about correlation. And that memory has to be represented as a memory, not just part of one's occurrent input. So I think this question that you posed is really the key question faced by any agent at all that's trying to get a model off the ground, which in a sense gets back to the question that Mike asked early on about how does this all start? Maybe it starts with babbling mm-hmm. in very simple systems.
Mm-hmm. You know, I was thinking recently this whole issue of how many agents are there and where is the border between the agent and the world and how do you self-model that border is a fascinating topic. And there's an amazing developmental model for this, which is that, you know, we often talk about one embryo and the embryo does this and the embryo does that. But actually, what happens at the beginning, let's say, for example, in amniote embryos, is that there's a flat blastodisc, which has just a few cell layers thick. So it's kind of, think of it like a Frisbee, and it just has a few cell layers. And normally what has to happen is that one point in this disc breaks symmetry and then organizes the primary axis of the first embryo and basically tells all the other cells, don't do it because I'm doing it. And that's how you end up with one embryo. Now, that process is very easily perturbed. And many people have done it. I used to do it in my graduate work. And what you can do is if you perturb that process, that initial blastodisc, that undifferentiated sort of pool of cells, which are these sort of low-level proto agents, that pool can break up into not one embryo, but actually multiple. And so you can have, so I did this in bird embryos, and you can have twins and chicken and duck and things like this. You can have it in humans have exactly the same structure. You can get them head to head. You can get them side by side. You can get all sorts of geometries. You can get triplets. You can get multiple individuals emerging by different partitions of this medium, this particulate medium where you have a bunch of cells. And you don't know ahead of time how many individuals at the level of how many larger individuals, so embryos, are going to arise from this medium because the dynamics by which, and that's, you know, local activation and long range inhibition and things like that, the dynamics that break up that undifferentiated ocean of potential selves into one, two, or three or more selves is actually it's very dynamic. It can go different ways. And then you get interesting things like this. So, for example, you might know that human conjoined twins that are, you know, sort of stuck together side to side, one of the twins often has left-right asymmetry defects. And it's because when you have two twins side by side, the cells in the middle, both twins can't quite agree on who they belong to. Are they the right side of this twin or are they the left side of that twin? And both twins think they belong to them, but in fact, they're overlapping. They're the same cells. And so one side will have correct left and right. The other side will have like two rights, for example. Right? And this ends up giving one of the twins laterality defects with respect to heart and gut patterning. And so their models, each twins as the collective of cells tries to compute things like which where things are and what's left and what's right and so on, their models can disagree with each other. They can draw the boundary between self and world in different ways, and you can have these sort of disputes over certain areas as to where who they actually belong to. And so I'm just incredibly interested in this process of individualization, so to speak, out of this like ocean of potentiality, these cells, you know, 50,000 cells, and some number of individuals at the embryo level will be formed, and each of them will have specific goals in morphospace. Each of them will try to achieve very specific morphologies, and then you don't know ahead of time how many there were going to be, you know.
Huge update. I just launched a Substack a few weeks ago. It was somehow awarded the 2024 Featured Publication Award. If you enjoy these videos, remember that they're usually available several days or even weeks ahead of time on my Substack. Click the link in the description to head over there now and subscribe. The writings there are currently about language, ill-defined concepts, the behind the scenes of the highs and lows of meeting Roger Penrose. That one went semi-viral, by the way. As well as some of the other mathematical details. There's much more being written there. It's content that isn't available anywhere else. It's not even on Theories of Everything, the YouTube channel. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people say to me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics and philosophy and consciousness. What are your thoughts? Now, while I remain impartial during the interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Head over to curtjaimungal.substack.com and subscribe.